After he waits 4 long months, God opens up the door for Nehemiah to openly speak to the king about the concerns of his heart. Nehemiah brings the petition before the king and he says, I want to go back and to rebuild the walls that had been torn down in the place where my fathers was buried. The king goes on to give Nehemiah not only favor and permission, but he also grants Nehemiah provision and protection for his journey. Nehemiah arrives back at Jerusalem and he surveys the damage that had been done. He goes in a cloak of darkness to examine exactly how much damage had been done over the course while they were in captivity. And then he imparts the vision to the people. He tells the people, look, I got a testimony that God has given me favor to come and do a great work. But I can't do it all by myself. I need some bona fide men who just believe God and will take him at his word and don't mind helping a brother rebuild these walls. The people with one accord says that they will help Nehemiah, that God will strengthen their hands. But anytime you set your mind to do a work for the Lord, rest assured that the enemy will be eavesdropping. Two men by the name of Sanballat and Tobiah, they overhear what is going on, the plans to rebuild the wall, and they mock and they scoff at the vision of Nehemiah. And sometimes you got to just encourage yourself that if nobody is laughing at your vision, then your vision ain't big enough. Sometimes you got to have crazy faith to say, I know it sounds ridiculous. I know it sounds insurmountable. But if God called me to it, he's going to strengthen my hands to see it come to pass. They come and they say, look, God can't build this wall. It's ridiculous to think that you could do such a thing. And Nehemiah does not fall into the trap of arguing with haters. All he does is he prays and he plans. Because prayer is not enough. You got to pray and you got to plan. Because you can do all the talking in the world to God that you want, but eventually God is going to give you instructions to carry out. And so you got to be praying and you got to be planning if you want to see this great work come to pass. After the verbal attacks and assaults on Nehemiah, the people don't work. Sanballat and Tobiah, they make a ploy to bring physical harm to the people of God. And they say that they're going to set this army and that they're going to kill everybody who got their mind set to work on the wall. And we understood a few weeks ago that you got to be ready for worship and you got to be ready for warfare. It's not enough just to say, oh, hallelujah, oh, praise the name of the Lord, oh, thank you, Jesus. You got to be ready so when the enemy comes, you are equipped to fend him off. So Nehemiah and the people, they worked with one hand, but they had a sword in the other hand. Tempting and testing from the enemy will make you battle ready. You got to be battle ready. And you cannot spend all your time at the church. At some point in time, you got to get up from your seat. You got to hit the streets and you got to get working on the wall that God has assigned for you. They are strengthened by the encouragement of Nehemiah. Nehemiah says, look, I know we face opposition, but there are some things that are just worth fighting for. You got to fight for your family. You got to fight for your children. You got to fight for your home. And no matter what comes and no matter what goes, you got to be ready to sacrifice for those that you love. Over the course of this rebuilding process, we found out that internal turmoil begins to rise up. The people of Israel begin to tax one another. It's one thing to have opposition from the outside. It's another thing when you got opposition within your own company. It's another thing when opposition comes from your family. It's another thing when opposition comes from your church family. You got to be ready. Not, the enemy does not just operate on the outskirts. Sometimes the enemy has crept in right next to your neighbor. I'm not going to ask you to turn to your neighbor because your neighbor might have brought the devil in with him. But I'm just go back to the opposite periphery. Each other. They created this caste system of the have and the have nots. And those who were rich taxed those who were poor. And it caused them to mortgage their property. It caused them to go into debt. And they fell so low that it caused them to sell their own children into slavery. But Nehemiah, being the man that he is, he's grieved by the report that he hears, and he challenges the nobles of the city to stop taxing their own people. And we highlighted Nehemiah as this sacrificial servant who bypassed, even though he was a governor, and even though he was allotted a portion of food, he said that which was due to him so that he can mingle and identify with the people who did not have. And sometimes it's incumbent upon us to sacrifice that which we know is due to us so that we can provide a better for those who don't have. I know you don't make it. I know you don't got a good job. I know you've got a promotion. But there are some folk who are still struggling. There are some folks still in the hood. There's still some folk with that ghetto mentality who have yet to make it out. But we got to reach back and grab those people and say, come on out. Come on out and come on up, because we can make it if we do it together. And now, we come to our text on today, and we find that Nehemiah is just about complete with the work of the wall. But how many know that the devil does not rest? And if he can't get you one way, he's going to come back and try you another way. And the Bible says at the opening of Nehemiah chapter 6 that here comes the three stooges, Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem, and they come and they heard that the wall was just about complete. And they try now that the ridicule has not worked, and now that the physical threats have not worked, now they try a new tactic, and they try deception. They say unto Nehemiah, look, we got off on the wrong foot. This was all just a misunderstanding. I know we fell out before, but I didn't mean no harm. How about this? How about you come down off the wall and come and counsel with us? Come let us reason together. Come let us have a meeting of the minds. Anything that does not fulfill the assignment that God has on your life is from the devil. Anything that diverts you from fulfilling the call that God has given you is from the devil. Don't believe me? Nehemiah was told to complete the law, and he is just about at completion. But if Nehemiah comes down off the wall now, all his labor was in vain. Because the enemy's tactic was not to get Nehemiah off the wall to have a meeting, but they wanted to either arrest Nehemiah or outright assassinate Nehemiah, because if he cut off the head, everything else will crumble. And so they go after Nehemiah, who is the leader. And there's a saying that heavy is the head that wears the crown. They attack Nehemiah time and time and time again. But Nehemiah has the type of relationship with God that when attacks come from the enemy, he does not fight in his own strength, but he reaches up to a God who has supernatural power to give him the power to keep on going. So Nehemiah does not come off the wall, but he sends a message back to them. And he makes this declaration. He says, look here, I am doing a great work so that I cannot come down. Why should the work cease while I leave it and come down unto you? Nehemiah said, y'all ain't slick. Ain't nobody got time for that. If I come down off the wall now, the work is going to stop. And if the work stops, you give room for the enemy to wreak havoc. So, because the thing about it is, when you are not busy about the things of God, the devil will make you busy with other stuff. And the title, I forgot to give y'all the title for this morning. The title for this morning's message is Discipline Over Distraction. Discipline over distraction. Because the distraction will come in life. Life is full of distractions. You ain't got to search hard. You ain't got to search high and low. You can find a distraction if you want one. You ever be trying to do something productive and you just end up on Facebook? You ever tried it? You're supposed to be productive, but you end up on Instagram or Twitter. You try to be productive, but then your phone rings. You try to be productive, but then you don't pick up the newspaper. And now it's 2.5 hours later, and you ain't did nothing. You ain't got in a shower. You ain't brushed your teeth. You ain't combed your hair. You ain't got nothing. But you got distracted. Yes, sir. Because the enemy operates, and he runs rampant in distraction. And so send out to Tobiah and Geshem's pulling was, if we can distract Nehemiah from the work, then we can get the work to cease and we can kill the whole project. I know they almost had completion, but if we can get them now, there's still time. There's still hope. There's still a chance that he will come down and we can kill him. So Nehemiah says, oh, they tried this tactic 4 times. And every time Nehemiah sent back the same message, he gave the response of Jesus, I'm busy about my Father's business. That's all you got to tell the enemy when the enemy comes. I am busy about my Father's business. They tried Nehemiah 4 times. And then after that does not work, they try a new tactic. They tried rumors and slander. Rumors and slander. Because when you name the name of Christ, rest assured that your name will be dragged through the mud. You will be called everything but a child of God. They will call you a liar, a cheater, a backbiter, a stealer, and whatever. Through the mud. Because when you're doing a work, you can't please everybody. And there will be some people that don't understand the assignment on your life. We got a bunch of Monday morning quarterbacks who want to sit on the couch of their own life judging your life because they're too lazy to work for themselves. It's almost football season, right? Tis the season for Monday morning quarterbacks. Those who don't know a center from a wide receiver, don't know a head coach from a general manager, but they got every opinion about what's going on the field. Y'all still are fans, right? Right now, according to y'all, the Steelers about to go undefeated and to the Super Bowl. I saw how I tell you that the devil is a liar. Here's where we're coming to. Specifically, somewhere around November, if my memory serves me correctly, it's November the 13th. The Steelers will take the field. Oh. Yeah, on their field. And so everybody has work to do on the field. So you cannot concern yourself with those who want to sit in the sidelines, who want to sit in the stands and ridicule and mock you for the work that you're doing. There will be those who just do not understand what God is doing in your life, the work that He's calling you to do. And if you become distracted about what the outside is saying, you stop being busy about what's going on with you. And so, they try and send an open letter. And this open letter was meant so it could get around to everybody. And the rumor was, Nehemiah, you only build the wall so that you can become king of Judah. You have hired people to talk about how there's a new king in Judah. But mind you where Nehemiah came from. Nehemiah had the utmost trust of the king by being his cupbearer. Anything that came to the king had to pass through Nehemiah. So he had no reason to try to usurp his position. Nehemiah's only concern was to rebuild that which was torn down by the enemy. But the rumor was that if we can get Nehemiah's name dragged in the mud, then the people will not follow. So Nehemiah says, look, in today's terms, he says, y'all made that up. That ain't come from nowhere over here. Y'all conceived that in y'all own hearts and try to spread this rumor. You ever hear something so outlandish about you that you, what? Some things ain't even worth addressing because they're just so ridiculous that they just, there's some things that just don't even fit your character. They don't even match anything you got on. There's some folks just stand by. Because the intent is, if they can ridicule your name, then they can distract you from the work. And there will be people who don't understand what God is doing in your life, and they will call you everything but a child of God. And if you consume yourself with fighting off everything that is said about you, you spend too much time talking to the enemy and not enough time talking to God. The Bible says, stand still. Will outlive your haters. Your character will outlive rumors. Your character will outlive slander. So stay in character and stay on the field. Now that this open letter does not work, Nehemiah, up in verse number 10, he seeks the counsel of Shemaiah, who was supposed to be a prophet. And he prophesies to Nehemiah. Well, he prophesies. Catch that. There's those who prophesy, and there's those who prophesy. Amen, lights. This prophelier comes, and he says, let us meet together in the house of God within the temple, and let us shut the doors of the temple, for they will come to slay thee. Yea, in the night will they come to slay thee. He says, look, Nehemiah, they will kill you. Remember, God told me to tell you to come to the temple and hide because they're trying to kill you. God told me to tell you. Y'all heard that before, right? God told me to tell you to go hide. But God told me in mind to stay on the wall. You got to do some evaluation. Amen. Can I tell you how to use your discernment, how to exercise your discernment to determine a prophet from a false prophet? You got to weigh the content of the information. Weigh the content of the information. After you weigh the content of the information, examine the character of the messenger. After you examine the character of the messenger, take it back to the Word of God. And if the content and the messenger does not align with the Word, then that messenger and that content is a lie. And the Bible says, let God be true and every man a liar. So I don't care who it came from. You better check the content, check the messenger, and line it back up with God's Word, because God's Word don't lie. So Nehemiah, he examines the instructions, and he says in verse 11, should such a man as I flee, and who is there that, being as I am, would go into the temple to save his life? I will not go. Nehemiah recognized, I am the leader of this project. I am the leader of this movement. And so if I run it high, everybody else is going to run it high too. I'm going to be courageous enough to stand my ground and fulfill the call that God has on my life. And so sometimes the enemy comes from a source that you think is spiritual. God will use even those in the church to try to get you off your target. I know y'all been going to the same church for 5, 10, 15, 20 years. I know you hold them in high esteem. But you got to check every bit of content that comes your way. And I'm talking from myself to anything that comes over the pulpit, you better weigh the content. Oh, all right. I'm just going to take my word for it. Weigh everything that comes across the pulpit. Because not everything that is preached in the pulpit is from God. So the Bible says, test, try, prove, and mind those things that are good. If you don't weigh the content, you can be prophylactic to and be diverted from God's purpose on your life. Amen. And so Nehemiah says, I will not go because I am not a man that I should hide. And then verse 20 says, look, I perceive that God had not sent him, but he pronounced this prophecy against me, for Tobiah and Sanballat hired him. He's a hireling. He's not a true shepherd. He's one who comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And so Nehemiah said, you ain't even from God. You a hired false prophet. And so he does not fall into the trap. And Nehemiah chooses discipline over distraction, because these distractions came from a multitude of areas. But Nehemiah kept his eyes on the prize. He kept his eyes on the one who had called him. Because if it is God who truly called you, it is God who's going to strengthen you in that calling. It's God who's going to reinforce the courage of your conviction when you want to give up. It's going to be God who comes along and who lifts you up when you want to be weak in the knees. It's going to be God who props you up on every leg of that when you get to be leaning to the right. And Nehemiah lets us understand that some of us are almost completed with the situation that God has assigned to us. But it's at this juncture in your assignment that the devil is going to raise a multitude of distractions. to try to get you to abort the mission. But you got to be like Nehemiah and choose discipline over distraction. You got to cancel all communication that is not productive to your assignment. You got to, sometimes you got to change the frequency that you're on, because you've allowed too much interference and feedback, and it's distracting you from hearing the voice of God. You hear too many other voices, and sometimes you have to get alone and by yourself so that you can hear God and God alone. Sometimes it's good to disconnect the phone number. Sometimes it's good to change your number. Sometimes it's good to use the block function, because there are those who will try to interfere with the frequency that God is trying to speak into your life. And it's only until you clear that frequency that you allow God to speak and use discernment and discipline over distraction. And Nehemiah is a type and a shadow of a man named Jesus. Jesus came with an assignment on his life. His assignment was to rebuild the bridge that had been torn down between man and God. The bridge that was set ablaze by our disobedience and our sins. And so, just like Nehemiah, Jesus refused to be distracted. After fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, here comes the devil. And he says, why don't you just turn these stones into bread? He tries to use the word of God. He tries to manipulate the scriptures. And if you don't know the word of God for yourself, the enemy knows some sentence of God's word. And he's good at manipulating just a few words to get you out of sync with God. But Jesus, the word made flesh, corrects the enemy and says, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of the Father. And then he said, look, you were supposed to be somebody. You were supposed to be a Messiah. You were supposed to be a king. But where's your king? Where's your following? Where are those who God told you would be yours? Come on up to the temple and throw yourself off. And after you throw yourself off, call on your angels, and they will come and they will save you from dashing your foot against the body. He manipulates God's word. He tries to get Jesus out of sync with his calling. And Jesus was smart enough to understand that you cannot correct the devil with your own clever quotes and sayings. I know you got a college degree. I know you went to the best high school. I know you went to community college. I know you went to trade school. But you are not smart enough to convince the enemy to back up off you with your own clever quotes. You got to spit back the word of God to back the devil up off you. And you got to respond, it is written. Not something you wrote in your diary. Not something you wrote on your palm pad. But you got to say, it is written and quoted from the word of God. And so many times along the way, there were those who tried to get Jesus off target, even up into the point of Calvary. Jesus is in the garden, and he's crying out to the Father. He says, if there be any other way, then let this cup pass, reveal it unto me, but nevertheless not my will, but your will be done. And as he got closer to finishing his assignment, the opposition increased, and he was mocked, and he was beaten, and he was ridiculed, and he was was spit upon, and he was whooped all night long, all in an effort to try to stamp out his assignment. And even when they hung him on Calvary's cross, and they put the nails in his hands, and they put the nails in his feet, and they pierced his side, the enemy was still talking. They said, he saved others. Come down off the cross and save yourself. They wanted Jesus to abort his assignment. But if you were like me, I'm so glad Jesus stayed on that old rugged cross. I'm so glad that in the midst of opposition, in the midst of ridicule, in the midst of being beaten, battered, scorned, and mocked, my Jesus and his Jesus stayed on the cross. He could have came down, but he wouldn't have finished the assignment. And they buried my Jesus in a borrowed tomb. And on that Friday, the enemy began to get happy. We stamped out his assignment. Saturday, they got a little more confident. We ain't heard from him in 1 to 2 days. But there, comes a shift, and the enemy's smiles turn to frowns. Because early, before your alarm clock went off, that kind of early, on Sunday morning, something began to shake. Something began to rock. Something began to move. And my Jesus and your Jesus got up from the grave with all power in his hands. And because he got power, because I associate myself with the God of my salvation, I've been invested that same resurrection power. And so just like Jesus stayed on assignment, he's calling us, stay on the wall. Don't come down for no haters. Don't turn around because of rumors. Don't engage in slander, but stay on your assignment to rebuild the wall. Jesus got up from the grave, the wall and the bridge was complete. So now you and I can walk across the bridge, and we can walk directly into the throne room of God, and we can say, here I am, Lord, your own feeble servant. Here I come, I lay my petitions at your feet. I come to adore your holy and your righteous name. I come to thank you for another day's journey.
Assignment, but it's God's grade. Because